of you. Welcome to today's session of economics again. Before anything else, I would like to plead with you to subscribe to our channel. Please try to ring the notification bell so that whenever I make some new videos, you will be the first to notice and also have an update on what we're doing. In recent times, I've been focused on doing things around economics, that is to support students across the world, those who are currently writing any form of examinations or who wants to further understand the concept of economics. Now, today I'm going to work around the circular flow diagram. I am not using a PowerPoint today, I'll try somehow to attach the PowerPoint to this video so that you can be able to follow it where you do not understand. You will be able to read for yourself and acquaint yourself with some of the concepts. Yeah. Now, circular flow diagram is a grade 12 topic, even though it's been treated in grade 10 in South Africa. It has been further elaborated in grade 12. And for examination purposes, I would keep this video on a grade 12 standard so that if they go to write the examinations or they want further clarifications on the topic, they will be able to watch this video and understand the concept better. Thank you very much. Now, what is a circular flow diagram? What is a circular flow? If we talk about circular flow, it is the flow of goods and services within the economy or within the borders of a country. Or alternatively, you can say it is the flow of goods and what and the money within the economy or within the borders of a country. That is the flow of goods and services, and then the flow of money within the economy of a country. That is a circular flow. Now, what is a circular flow diagram? This diagram is just an illustration of how goods and services and money flows within the participants in an economy. I am going to take that again. What is a circular flow diagram? First, I explain what is a circular flow, and now I'm trying to explain what is a circular flow diagram. Circular flow diagram, it's a diagram or it is a model that shows how the flow of goods and services flow within the economy of a country. Now, what is a model? A model is the representation of reality. We're using something to represent the reality. That is a model. So, circular flow diagram is a... Okay, there was a break in there. However, I will continue this. Yeah. So I was trying to explain what is a circular flow diagram. I said it's a model of the representation of reality that indicates how goods and services flow within the economy. Goods, services, and money, how they flow in an economy, is what we call the circular flow diagram. Now, if we look at the circular flow diagram, the circular flow diagram speaks about two types of economy, indicating that there are two types of economy that we have. In any part of the world, there are two types of economy. The first one we have is the closed economy. The closed economy. And then we also have the open economy. Now, what is a closed economy? What is a closed economy? A closed economy is an economy that does not do business with other countries, which means there are no imports and there are no exports from that country. I'm going to take it again. A closed economy is an economy that does not do business with other countries or with other economies. It simply means that there are no imports and there are no exports in that country, nothing like that. They basically focus on feeding their own people It's domestic production, or let me simply say it's about domestication. They produce and feed themselves. They do not buy from other countries and they do not sell to other countries. That is a closed economy. Now, the question is, do we have any country in this modern world that is practicing a closed economy? It will be very rare to find. India once practiced such in 1919. They've once practiced closed economy where they feed themselves. They do not buy and export to any country. Brazil is quite closed if we take imports out of the equation. But currently, with globalization and things that are going on, it will be very difficult for any country to live or practice the closed economic system. Therefore, there is no such closed economic system. Even if you try to practice closed economic system, you will need to buy some other resources. All countries, there is no country that has everything. You might have the labor, you might have minerals, but then you can't have everything. No country has all the resources to produce all that they want. Even most, not every country has all the necessary skills that if it has to do with human resources, you know. So it's very difficult to practice a closed economic system in recent times. Now, who are the participants in a closed economy? There are only three participants in a closed economy. One, the first participant in every economy, whether closed or open, is the household. Now, who are the households that we talk about? The households are the individuals that you find in the economy. The people that are living there in the economy, let's take it, if I say a household, I mention a household, let's say the Modise family, it's a household, all right? So they are participants in the economy. I can say the Muruti family, it is also a household on its own. So these are participants in the economy. So households are the first participants in any economy. For an economy to exist or to run effectively, there is a need for this group of people, which is the households. Now, the second participant in every economy, it's what? They are the firms or the businesses. The firms or businesses. Now, what do firms or businesses do? We already know. They are into production. They produce and they offer us a lot of services. If you come to the insurance, they offer us services. If you go to the banking industry, they offer us services. If you go to, the meat factories, they produce meat for us, which is a product. You know, if you go to the mill or the maize factory, they produce mill for us. If you go to the milk factory, they produce milk for us. You know, so these are firms or businesses into production, and the banking and the insurance sectors are into services, including what? Education. There are private schools that we have, and these are also businesses. There are private churches that we have. They are also producing services, but I only consider churches as a private businesses that participate in the economy, that is if they're paying tax to the government. All right. So now, the third participant in a closed economy is the government. The government is the third participant. Apart from the household, I consider the government as one of the most important participants in the economy, because we can take the businesses out. However, the government will produce goods and services to the citizens of every country. The government is this the responsibility of every government to make sure that its citizens are able to, you know, are able to feed, are able to wear clothes, are able to have shelter. Those are the basic necessities of life, and those are some of the responsibilities of every government. Therefore, for the households to get these things, the government will need to produce these things in the absence of firms or businesses. That is why I say that apart from the business, apart from the households, the government plays a major role in every economy. All right. So in every closed economy, there are only three participants. We have the first one is the households, the second one is the businesses, and then the third one that we have is the government. All right. Now, I would like to go on with what? The open economy. The open economy is just the opposite of the closed economy. I explained that closed economy are economies that do not do businesses with each other, or they do not do businesses with other countries. Now, an open economy is the opposite. They do businesses with other countries. So if you can understand or you can explain what is a closed economy, it becomes easy for you to explain what is an open economy. One is closed, one is open. When it is open, it means that they allow themselves to import and export. They allow themselves to do businesses with other countries without any form of hesitations. They buy goods from other countries and they import. Almost every country, especially when it comes to trading of oil, most countries are buying from other countries. Those countries that cannot produce oil, they buy. Those countries that cannot produce rice, they buy from other countries. Those countries that cannot produce quality clothes, they buy from other countries. You know, today, all over the world, we can see multinational companies that from one country, they settle in other countries. A typical example is McDonald's. McDonald's is now everywhere in every country. Now, if they have to produce a particular meal, let's say something that they do not have in their country, they definitely have to import it. You know, if you go to KFC, they are into chicken. If their country cannot produce good quality chickens, they will have to import them. You know, so every country now is importing, every country now is exporting. That is why I said it's very difficult for you to get what? An economy that is on its own, that does not depend on any other country. Now that we understand the concept of an open economy, I want us to understand the participants in an open economy. In a closed economy, there are three participants. And in an open economy, there are five participants. Now, if you can understand and remember the three participants in the closed economy, all you need is two extra to add to the open economy to complete the participants in the open economy. Now, I've been using the word participants. I don't know if you do not understand what a participant is. In simple terms, you can call them the players in the economy. The players in the economy. All right. So we said that in a closed economy, there is a household, there are firms or businesses, and there is government. Now, if we come to what? The open economy, we have the households, we have the firms or businesses, we have the government, we have what? The foreign sector. We have the foreign sector in there. All right. We have the foreign sector in the open economy. I don't know if there is any other one I've forgotten. They are five. They are five. I said household, firms, government, the foreign sector, and the financial institutions. Yes, I think I left out the financial institutions. These are the five participants in every economy. Now, in my next video, I will try to link the way these participants interact with each other in every economy. I will try to put them together for you to see how these businesses interact with each other. With that much ado, I would like to bring this section to an end, and I hope that you will be able to subscribe to this channel. If there is something you do not understand, I urge you to put your comments below and I will explain to you if you are in grade 12 and intends to pass your examinations, then I think you should hook onto this channel, because I am going to break everything down from chapter to chapter. You know, if you think that you do not understand your teacher, then you can also try this video. Who knows? This could be your best opportunity to get a lot of things you do not understand better. I hope this video does somebody good and you will subscribe. And if you find it important, you find that that is educative, please pass it on to the next person that you think also will need it. Thank you for watching. Till I come your way again next time, it has always been Romeo. Thank you.